Yep. Okay. Okay.
Easy. No decisions are made.
Okay.
We need to take a quick break before.
I'm just getting out of there, Ed, sorry. Actually, I need to just turn around.
Okay.
Do it up correct.
What's that?
Yeah.
Hey, Brett, how are you?
Good.
How's the wrestling goes for you?
No, I'm fine.
Good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
We did.
I
was years later because you just had lots
of
okay. Good morning. How's everybody?
Good morning. How's Mr. Scott?
Great. How are you?
Not doing too bad.
How are you?
Good.
Rodney hasn't gotten me sick yet.
Yeah, I sure appreciate you still checking in on him.
And Susan hasn't gotten me sick yet.
Well.
Which is a good thing.
That's a great thing. That's a great thing. Rodney, has he been calling in?
He did want to.
Oh, did they? All right.
He won. I guess he wanted to.
Okay.
Can't even take a day off
to
the hospital.
Man. Plus it's hard.
Yeah, if he behaves, they want, they said he might let him out this afternoon.
Good deal. He's been there a while. Well, 5 or 6 days, right?
Yeah, they came in Friday afternoon.
No.
Rodney is not a very good housekeeper, so he doesn't have the best way of commissions as far as that goes. There's only 3 people that he allows in his house, himself, Patrick, and myself.
Oh, really?
Yeah. When we moved you down from Denver, Patrick and I made a deal. He'd keep Rodney occupied upstairs for a while, and I'd be downstairs sorting stuff, and our to the dump pile was bigger than the safe pile. And then I'd get him down there and go over stuff, and then he was making his pile.
Rodney was or Patrick?
Patrick was.
Okay.
Yeah. He's a hoarder. I bet you we threw about 3 tons of magazines. And newspapers.
He has a good price.
You wouldn't actually make
the yeah.
There is that Fund 39 report. And it looks like there's about $28,000.
And that's what we want.
Is that what they help?
Yes.
So
yes.
He does actually have it?
Yes. But it's in Fund 39.
Okay. That's where his grant money ended up?
Well, I don't know if that's grant money. I just show that there's about $28,000 in the special fire fund.
Okay.
But
so we could call him.
I don't know if that's grant money or not.
Okay. I need to talk. He needs to talk to them guys. He's even more than I do.
Okay. Do you want me to give this to Danny then?
Yeah.
Okay. Come on up, Scott.
All right.
More than I can tell him.
Did we talk to him?
Yeah. He's moving, so it must be on.
Thank you, sir.
Sure. How are you, Nicole?
Good. How are you?
Great. Good morning. Pleased to say that this year's
got off to a pretty good start with regard to our census. This month in particular, we've been average between 7 and 12, so that's unusual in a very good way. And so, combined with January and February, you know, obviously we've had a few lulls in there, but overall, I think certainly compared to last year, as we finish up the first quarter here, we'll be in a much stronger vantage point just with regard to the census than we were last year. If there's any specific questions on the volume front, I'd be happy to address those. But a couple of noteworthy additional items there. We did get Terry Newell in as a replacement for Brenda Hayes, who stepped down as our director of nursing. Terry has several decades of nursing experience, and so we're very fortunate that she was able to come and offer a good look at things. Right now, the plan is for her to be here kind of in a bridge capacity. I don't anticipate her moving here, or she's very well established in the eastern part of the state, and you know, that's where her husband is as well. But we were fortunate, like I said, to get her to come in, and as we look for that permanent DON hire, you know, she's going to get outstanding assets. We've working on getting the schedule pinned down for orthopedic specialist and a pulmonologist. The pulmonologist is waiting on his Kansas credentialing. And as soon as that's finished, they will start coming here once a month. So the plan for now, I'm anticipating them a half day a month, which they'll be traveling together, and that will be certainly a nice privilege to have them in our facility. On that note, I didn't include it in my remarks, but Dr. Swinehart, our dermatologist, is no longer coming to St. Francis, so we'll also be keeping our eye out for opportunities on that front as well. Tammy Church, as you guys are aware, was hired for our community paramedicine program. So although we were sad to see her go from our staff, she's going to work in an excellent capacity with the grant. As you guys know, she's a very strong clinician and nurse, and I think will be the perfect fit for as we get this program underway and try and build those numbers up. I think so I would definitely expect that to pick up now that she's in the seat. Continue to work with Reed and our EMS brethren in with regard to emergency preparedness. Tammy Wood, the regional emergency coordinator, visited and spent the day with us, helped us out quite extensively. And we're having her come back again just so we can make sure that we leverage her experience and as we head into the summer months, especially if there was a significant event to occur. You know, we've recognized several areas that warrant a little bit more scrutiny and some process improvement, and so she's been a great asset as we do that, and I'm very pleased with the process improvements that we've made, particularly by way of communication. I have a copy of our annual review for your reading enjoyment. I'll drop one off for Rodney. Basically, I will say this remains in draft format just because I haven't had the opportunity to get the board president's signature, but I would anticipate this being the final solution. It's gone back and forth, and they've reviewed it, and I think we've gotten to our last edition. So with that, I will solicit any questions or feedback you have, and then that will get signed and logged. The annual review is a CMS condition of participation, so that each year, and I'll make sure going forward that you guys get a copy of that. There's a lot of good things with regard to our volume and finances that I think will be advantageous for you guys. The way I constructed that is basically off of not only the mandatory things that we're obligated to discuss in the interview with CMS, suggested not obligated, but also with regard to our strategic plan and our four pillars, tying those two together the way we're going to do it going forward. So let me know if you have any questions there. And then finally, we have been getting a few complaints with regard to some errant late notifications from the Great Plains Central Billing Office. They're aware of the problem, and I've been speaking with them extensively on this topic, and I'm confident that they are working diligently to.
I'll tell you personally, I got two bills, one for $791 and then one for $570, and they were dated back from May and June of last year.
Oh, wow.
And I'm sitting there, and I called the gal, and she is not a very nice person. I actually said, is it your job when you wake up to try to make somebody on the other end of the phone mad?
Yikes.
And I said, you know, I don't really care, because you're not going to make me mad. But when I call her back, I'm going to say, you know, I got these bills. What if I was running on a cafeteria plan that didn't come, you know, didn't go over to the next year? Are you billing me for these services? You know, they're not nice people. So, yes, that's good that you're checking into that.
We've had some very candid conversations here recently, so.
And I file a lot of claims for employees, their EOBs when they come back. And when they're back in May, June, and July of last year from visits at the hospital, I'm like, wow.
Yeah.
Something's not functioning properly. Something needs to be addressed.
Some of it may not be all that, because I see that when I get the notifications, insurance pending, it'll pin me for 4 months.
Yeah, exactly.
And that is one of my complaints with United Healthcare as a physician and as a, you know, so it's not all Great Plains, but by the time she gets it and it's, you know, it's time to pay it, the gal is like, well, this has been going on for, you know, 6 months, 8 months, 9 months.
Yeah.
So,
and I want to be clear, I'm not offering the public scoriation of Great Plains in any fashion, but I did want to highlight the fact that we are working together to address that.
That's good. You're doing a good job, Scott. We had one thing. We had budgeted $6,630. This is going to High Plains Mental Health.
Right.
And we need an additional $10,741.68. And Commissioner Radcliffe brought this to our attention. Is that something that Cheyenne County Hospital is going to pick up, or?
That should get picked up this year and next with the grant.
Okay.
But following the expiration of the grant, I would probably expect the county, because basically that bill is a direct result of the fair funding model that the High Plains Mental Health uses. And basically, they have a magical equation that identifies, you know, all of the counties participating in their services,
right.
You know, the spare funding that each county disperses.
So that's
where
we've been well short. Yeah.
And so that, we leveraged a grant to make up the difference in order to allow for in-house services through High Plains Mental Health.
So fiscal year 2016-17, that $10,000 difference will be taken through a grant?
Two more cycles.
Okay.
And let me make sure that dollar figure drives with what Carol is tracking. But that's my understanding. And if I need to offer a correction, I will get back to you. But that is the way that, in my mind, it should be flowing for years 1, 2, and 3. There's a 3-year grant cycle, and we had budgeted for that difference with regards to the fair funding standards. So I will double check. It was 10,000.
10,741. Okay. And 68 cents.
So I'll get with Carol and make sure that I'm understanding that correctly with regard to those fund distributions with the grant. But
okay. We'll make sure in 2 years of the budget something.
Okay.
Thank you, Scott.
Sure.
Okay. Did you have anything else?
No. Like I said, I would certainly appreciate if you have any questions or feedback with regard to the annual review. And continue to work to get Mr. Radcliffe back on his feet.
Yes, you did. Good job.
All right. Thanks a lot. Appreciate it.
I may call you this. I had an incident.
Okay.
All right.
Oh, that's good. Is the whole committee coming?
I doubt it, but I think several will be there.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. Pardon my name, yeah.
Let's see if Dave in here. 15 minutes. Because it sounds like he's got people coming in, so we better wait for him. If yeah, that's okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
Awesome. Ready.
Yep.
Could you?
I gotta put a pin in the excavator.
Oh.
When you guys are driving back to Wheeler, I got the excavator parked this way with my arm down because I had a big bucket full like this, and the pin broke.
I thought this was it when it was coming out.
The one on the back of the bucket broke.
The one on the top that controls the arm. I had that weight at about 7,000 pounds like this, and I was digging 40 foot hole coming up and down to 30 foot higher.
Now, I bet that made you a little nervous.
Oh, yeah. And that 3.5 inch pin, was that big around? They're not fun to drive in.
It didn't bend nothing on it.
Or it just sheared it off and didn't know. Sheared the crud out of me.
You used to call that a pucker factor.
Oh, what's that?
Pucker factor.
Oh, yeah. Literally. It all happens in slow motion. Something bad happens like that.
Morning. Dave Gills texted me and said that Clint Birch will accept the airport authority position.
Good.
Camp inspector come around and we got wrote up on three items. It's from over at the shop. I got on the picture of them. We had a yellow trouble light that had frayed ends and stuff like that, so we started in, bought a new one. We had a disc on this instead of the wheel, and so therefore this guard was not on it, so we put that back, and then we had that weight limits on the lift on the chain. So, on this letter, is a matter of we have to get it all corrected, and then you just have to sign off on it. I'd say at the bottom of the sheet.
Just down here, Dave?
Yeah, that'd be fine.
That was all they found.
As well. Get
that hell in there pointed out of.
Yeah, that's right. First thing that shelter things on the store. Date that too.
Okay.
Just any commissioner has to sign it, so.
Yeah, that would be you.
And that's just a what kind of form?
Alright. He wants to say, I'm sorry.
What kind of form is he signing? Recommendations?
Validating that the changes have been made. The corrections will say that I've got a protective guide for the disc, freight end, and a weight limit on the chair bearers.
I didn't say nothing about not having to wear eye protection or nothing. I was hanging there. Huh?
Okay. We're right up to safety standards there.
Yeah, right. We're on a tight ship.
Yeah. That's all I have until Dustin comes up. He's going to be here if I discuss this greater with you guys.
Oh, okay. Is that Dustin Daniels?
Yeah, it's been a while. That's really tough. Pretty good to go. Stop up and see what you guys say.
Okay.
Is this purifying gravel? Clean your ditches, elevate road, need a little drink of water on some of them, but
it sounds like we're gonna get some moistures.
Coming at the end of the month.
Are they doing on the edge or the same thing?
Same thing. It's still, when I say scarifying, the one thing different, we're not using scarifier teeth because there's always dragging, it seems like. So we're using our ripper teeth, we're using all five of them and not going quite as deep. But then using that Rome disc, a big heavy Rome disc, is really working out well for us. So, kind of chews it up and breaks up, you know, some.
You're not adding to water as you lay it back down.
Just lay it right back down. That's the reason that there's moisture to get it up, but the top, you know, is floury or dusty, I should say. So, we'll drink really good.
I'll make a copy of that, so just so I have the wording when I write those, write the minutes up.
Okay. I've already made a copy of this. You said you want another?
Did you give it to the girls in there?
No.
Yeah, just a copy and lay it on my desk, and then when I write the minutes up, I'll have the wording for all of that.
Okay, all right.
That's all we got. Thanks, Dave.
Who else is coming?
Well, I know that Eddie is coming, Eddie mm-hmm. Schultz. Mm-hmm. I don't know beyond that.
On some county cases, so
oh, okay.
I'll be slipping out
okay.
partway through. I just wanted to give
okay.
you a heads up so
yeah.
you wouldn't question why I was slipping out.
The only thing that I'm going to ask them to sign is It's just a revised letter from the accounting firm.
Okay.
The first letter was to do a review or a compilation.
Okay.
The second letter is an examination.
Okay.
That's the only change.
Okay.
Same price, everything.
Okay.
We just felt like an examination was a little bit more comprehensive for USDA.
Okay. So same cost, everything of that.
Same thing and same letter and everything.
Okay.
So
no problem.
I have that. If you want to take a peek at it, here it is.
Sure. Thank you.
Yeah.
With the new system, it's a little different than the others.
Mm-hmm.
So I told her that I would like to wait until you guys approve them before they go out, because otherwise you've got all these minutes approved and unapproved going back and forth. And with the new minutes, I don't really have a way of marking them as unapproved. So you don't know whether this has been approved by the board. And that's why if I wait until after you guys approve them, then we know that they're approved.
Where you been, Eddie?
I had a rough shirt off for a doctor's appointment.
Hello.
I think he's ready for us.
Yep, we're ready.
So I got your text, and I could either be here, or I could stop and answer. So I didn't answer.
No problem.
Do you not understand our text communication work? You always just respond to the text. Okay.
No matter why. Even if I run up a pole.
Okay, well, I thought I would kind of take us down memory lane just a little bit, kind of see how we got here. So what I'm seeking today on behalf of the Public Building Commission is the approval to submit our application to USDA.
Okay.
And the application has two pieces to it, two documents. It has a preliminary architectural report and a financial feasibility study. And I'll go over those a little bit later. But if you recall, there was a fire at the Good Samaritan Center in October 2010. At that time, they had 50 beds. After the fire and the remodeling, they opened in March of 2011 with 35 beds. There were a lot of community meetings held in the community about what to do. And then in August of 2011, there was an issue put on the ballot that would increase the property tax by 6 mills. And that passed. And that money was to be designated then for the senior living. So that tax has been in effect, and we have accumulation of about $400,000 in that fund. So during the next following years, the county negotiated with Good Samaritan, and then eventually was given the building for $1. Then in January of 2015, the Senior Living Task Force was formed and began to meet. And Todd Keller was the chair at that time. And now Eddie is our chair. So from May through September, we had a market study done by an independent organization to make sure that the market would support 8 to 12 assisted living units, and it said yes. And then we spent our time going through a process of interviewing and then selecting an architect and a contractor. And we came before you and recommended, and you chose those people. So in December, then, upon the recommendation of an attorney, Sarah Steele, she recommended that we form a Cheyenne County Public Building Commission. We did that. Eddie is the chair, and Rod Plucker is the vice chair. And then you appointed the members. So since then, we have been working with the architect on the design of the building, the assisted living, and then on the remodeling of the nursing home and the various costs. And Hutton Construction has been real good about giving us some estimated costs. So in all of our efforts, we've been using a budget that is going to use the total budget would not exceed what we can use from the mill levy. So there would be no other tax other than what the mill levy is already, people are already paying.
And have been since August of 2011.
Correct. So I just wanted to reinforce that point. Okay, so the preliminary architectural report, we do that. So, just going to give you a summary of this. This is put together by myself, the architect, the contractor, and the Public Building Commission. And yesterday, we spent 2 hours going through this report and the financial feasibility study. So we've made a lot of changes to this report to make sure it's accurate. But basically, in this report, you'll see that we're going to propose building a 10-unit assisted living. It would be on the property of the existing nursing facility. The 10 units, we'd have 9 one-bedrooms, that would be 500 square feet, and then we'd have 1 two-bedroom of 815 square feet. The total size of the building is 11,000 square feet, and estimated cost not to exceed $3.3 million for that piece. Okay, then on the remodeling of the nursing facility, this has been more of a challenge because we have a really old building.
So, I might say on assisted living, it'll go on the north side, and two of those apartment buildings will have to come down. They haven't been full. They have been recently, but historically, they've had 5 empty rooms. But I want you to be aware of that.
So in the nursing facility, right now we have 16 semi-private rooms and 3 private rooms. So in looking to the future, people would like to have their own space, you know, even if it's the size of a phone booth. We'd like to have our own space. So that's been the primary objective in the remodeling. With the plan that we're proposing, we would end up with 8 semi-private rooms. Then we would have 4, a new design of a semi-private room. And it appears that you have your own space, even though you're sharing the room. And then we would have 11 private rooms. So we would increase significantly the number of private rooms and decrease the semi-private. All of the rooms would receive some upgrades, and we're focusing on the bathrooms, because the bathrooms are just totally inadequate. And also we're putting in PTAC units. What these are just like when you stay in a hotel, you know, you have a unit that heat and cools through the wall. That's what we're proposing in the resident rooms, so that each resident can control their own heat and cool in their room.
You know, a lot of systems you have to either be on air conditioning or on heat. We put up with that at the church, you know, problem, but some rooms can have AC and some can have the heat on, and that, so that's really good.
We hope to replace all the windows in the resident rooms, because those are original windows, I think. So, and then we'll do some painting and some carpeting and things like that. So basically what we have left in our budget will go to the remodeling of the nursing home. And at this point, we're saying it should not exceed a cost of $2.3 million. So that the total all-in costs, that's architect, contractor, my fees, interest for borrowing money, initial for interim financing, would not exceed $5.6 million. And of course, we're not asking you at this point to approve $5.6 million, because we'll be coming back to you, Brett, and the commission, when we have the guaranteed maximum price, and then you can approve whatever amount.
The only thing that scares me is we're going to go from new remodel, we're going to go from 35 to 23 rooms. And
well, no, we're going to stick with 35.
Oh, okay.
Yes, we're going to
stick. You're going to make these, you're going to make 8, 4, 11.
So that'd be 16 plus 8 would be 24 plus 11.
Okay. Oh, I misunderstood you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. We're going to stick with 35.
You good. Good.
Yeah. That's yes, that's right. It wouldn't work if we did it otherwise.
Okay.
Yeah.
One of the things to point out, too, is the mechanical systems that have been looked at, plumbing and all of that has been addressed, and some in that cost for the long-term care, some of that will be replaced as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
And updated, replaced as necessary.
That's right. That's right.
We'll support these.
Okay. Then the financial feasibility study has been done by the SS&C accounting firm in Topeka, and they look at nursing homes, and so what they have prepared shows that the project will work financially, okay, based upon the contribution from the county of $225,000 a year. And I believe the 6 mil that we're generating now, about $260,000 a year, okay? The assumption in the financial report is that we borrow $5 million through the issuance of revenue bonds by the Public Building Commission, and that would be at a rate of 3% for 30 years that would be sold to USDA, Rural Development. Let me kind of explain this Public Building Commission and the county and Rural Development, okay? So I'm going to use let's say this is the Public Building Commission. The Public Building Commission is going to own all the buildings, all right? And so they're going to issue revenue bonds. Then the USDA is over here. They're going to buy those bonds, all right? The county is then going to lease the building from the Public Building Commission and pay a lease, like a rent. And that rent is a $225,000, okay? Then the Public Building Commission will pay back the bonds to USDA. So there are three parties involved here. But that's the structure of how these things are done according to Kansas law. And
the most efficient way
that's right.
to do it is to save taxpayer money.
Yes, yes, that's right. And so we've had that discussion with Rural Development, and they've done this before, so they seem to be comfortable with that.
So it's a little extra hassle to let Nicole say it's what you have to do. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, and to clarify, because I know there's been questions about the protest petition.
Yes.
And what that means. The protest petition has nothing to do with the initial mill levy. That money has been coming in since 2011 and will continue to come in. What it questions is the issuance of the revenue bonds. And so it's a matter
of the money.
Yeah, it's a matter of how to get the money that the county already has through an efficient process provided by state statute. So I just wanted to be clear on that because I know there's been questions both here and out in the community, people approaching me, what does a protest petition actually challenge? It doesn't challenge the money that's been coming in and approved for this project. It merely challenges what he just laid out, which is the issuance of the bond, which would then be sold to the USDA, allowing us to lease from PVC and take the money we already have, paying for it. So I just wanted to clarify for everybody that that's what the protest petition actually challenges.
And, you know, we know there ought to be an election, and we discussed that, and we feel that the August election, that there would not be really hardly any delay in our project, because we're going to keep the ball rolling.
Right.
Because keep in mind that that protest petition does not challenge the formation
right.
of the PVC, any of the plans, the mill levy that's already in existence. It's really what it's challenging is the mechanism by which the county would get the money we already have into the PBC project to build the center.
So we've got a lot of work to do, and we're going to continue doing that. And we just thought that having it on the August 2 ballot would be the cheapest way to do it, least cost. And that's what we want.
And if I may add, in the meantime, we have time to educate the public further on what Nicole just said.
Right, transparency is everything in a project like this.
Yep, and we'll have more, we'll have schematic drawings so that people can understand what it is. But they'll also see that this is about just the issuance of the bonds, which serve as interim financing and then
would this be helpful?
Permanent financing between the USDA and Fred Keel.
And so we have a flow chart on what you explained. You know, this is the county,
sure.
This is the Planning Board Commission, and this is the USDA.
Right.
And have yourself a flow chart and explain to them, you know, it's not going to cost them any more, and this is what's lately how it's supposed to be done.
Yeah, and I will say there are other mechanisms through which we could get the money that we already have through the mill levy to the PBC, but they would be less efficient and more difficult under the Kansas statutory scheme.
Didn't know that, thank
you. Okay. So there's still possible options to look into, but ultimately, I mean, when we're looking at efficiency and making sure that we're in full compliance, in a way that's going to use taxpayer money in the most efficient way possible, it's this arrangement.
Yeah. And that's what we're trying to do. Mm-hmm. I mean, we pay taxes too. We want to see it utilized to the best possible use.
And the wonderful thing right now on the interest rate with USDA, it's actually going to go down 2.78 next month. So if we can get our application in and get it approved, that doesn't mean we have to spend the money. What it means is that we have an approval.
Right.
And then we finish off all of our detail and get that guaranteed maximum price to come back to you so that you can say yay or nay. And then we can move ahead. So we're at a very good time.
That's a locked-in interest rate.
Is locked in for 30 years.
Yeah. Yep. When we first started talking to USDA, the rate was 3 5/8,
right.
And it's dropping. Mm. So
good time to do it.
Yeah, it is. We will be creating five new positions, five new employees, five FTEs. That'll be new employment in the county. It'll have a tremendous economic impact. You're going to keep elderly people in the community. And then we've only projected 9 out of the 10 being full in our financial projection. So we've tried to be a little bit conservative. Yeah. Yep. And then if everything goes well and we get a positive vote in August, we think that we could break ground late this fall. And it would take about, 12 months for the construction.
On the assisted living.
Yeah. Consider approving then just the application and including those documents. And we can get that off to USDA.
Yes.
Okay. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Okay.
And the last item here, Brett, is just simply revised letter from the accounting firm. We did a examination versus a compilation. It's the same price, but it's just a little bit more detailed report. So you've already signed the original letter. This is just kind of a revised letter.
And I have with you that.
Okay, thank you.
Well, if there are no other questions, thank you for your time.
Well,
we might just reiterate with the board about the putting the question on the August ballot.
Yeah, I guess, like I say, we recommended that we're comfortable with having that on the August ballot. And we'll be doing a lot of community meetings and informing the citizens about our progress and answering any questions and all of that. So,
you might be wrong.
I want to leave in a better place.
Well, you are. Thank you. We'll see you in a minute. Eddie, is that it? Down here or Scott?
No, down there because we're going to do some stuff.
Okay.
I got to take Sherry to the afternoon. I might be late.
So then if people have questions, they can actually directly ask questions.
Yeah, that's great.
Yep, sounds good.
Okay.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you. Sarah Steele will actually be sending me the wording to get on that ballot, kind of like Mike Day did with the pool. That way the Kansas statute gets recorded in the proper Kansas statute.
Do we try to get Cody in here? 15 minutes. I got a couple things to talk about.
Okay.
On the June 4th.
One of the two will be an executive session, so it's up to you guys. You want to do executive session first, or do you want to do it last?
Let's do it last, just so Nicole gets back.
Okay.
Did she go upstairs?
I don't think she did. I don't think she is until 10 o'clock.
Okay.
But she's a prisoner. So, the first thing, remember in the past I discussed our problems with Global Dispatch, the CAD system. We did have Interpol come up and spend the day with us and walk us through their product, talk to us, and they gave us a proposal for the new CAD operating system. I have since dealt with them and kind of deal with them, and we've got some money taken off of this proposal. They're going to give me a new proposal. The reason I want to go with Interpool is they're the only ones that are fully integrated that has a Kansas portal to get into the mandatory reports that we as a law enforcement agency have to send to the state. Right now we have to double that work, one for our own records and one for the state records. With Interpool we'll just be able to do the work once and send it off. Of course, you know how much we paid for Global, or I don't know if you guys knew that, so, you know, depends on how you look at things. But we're paying about $12,000 a year right now for maintenance fees on the current CAD system and the electronic record management system. If we go to Interpool, our monthly fee, our yearly fee will go down to $6,000, so it cuts our maintenance fee in half. To implement it, it's going to be around $31,000 plus we have to get a server. And I have a meeting tomorrow with Scott at the hospital. They have some servers coming offline. I'm going to see if any of them meet the specifications. I don't know yet or not, but I'll meet with him tomorrow and see if they do and what they want for them to use. If, you know, if not, we'll have to buy a server. We had everybody up from Ryan, Reed, the fire chiefs were invited. The city PD came up. Everybody agrees that they like the Interpool. Yeah, that's the one that they liked. It's an unanimous agreement. We'll be able to pay for a good chunk of this out of the 911 fund budget. Part of it we will not be able to pay out of there. It doesn't meet the specifications of the statute. But part of it we will be. What I'm trying to do now is trying to get it so that we do not have to pay any of that $12,000 in maintenance fees to any of the companies that we're currently doing business with. So that gives us another $12,000 that's already in our budget to put towards implementing this Global system. So basically I have a little bit of number crushing to do to see where we're going to get the money to pay for this. But this is the one that I would like to do. And I know Commissioner Radcliffe is not here. I've talked to him about this. I'm not going to push your guys for something today, a yay or a nay on Interpool. What I'd like to do is get together with you guys individually or something, talk to you if you guys have questions about it, and if we can make a motion at the next meeting, whether to go or not, because so many people are going to Interpool in the state of Kansas that they have a backlog. If we went with them today at this meeting, it'd probably be September before we got our bill done and all done up there. So, you know, every 2 weeks we put off, that's putting it off anymore. So, I would like, I'm just kind of presenting this to you so that next meeting, I'm going to ask for a motion whether to accept the proposal or not. By that time, I'll have one without scribbles on it with our new adjusted price, because I did do some wheeling dealing to get the price lowered. As far as the police department, there's two ways of doing it. We need to talk to the city council to see how they want to do it. Either they can bill us for everything, which includes the installation and their yearly maintenance fee, and we bill the city for their share that their city police department will use, or they go out on their own and purchase it and make their own payments. Global or Interpool is good either way. We just need to decide how we as two separate organizations want to take care of that. If they decide to go with it, I think they'd be very smart of them to go with it. It's a good deal. And
do you have any idea on the 911 fund budget that's available?
How much is out of it?
How much is going to be available for that?
I'm thinking around $14,000 is going to be available for the thing. That's what I'm saying. If we can get the $12,000 that's already in our budget,
and then the
$14,000 we'll just have a little bit of shortfall for the project.
And we wouldn't have the yearly maintenance, the $6,000 for up till
not till next year. Till next year.
Good. So we can budget.
That's what I'm saying. I'm hoping that we can articulate and get our yearly budget that we're paying to these other companies. Removed so that we can put it towards the purchase of this.
Right.
We won't have a yearly maintenance fee then if we switch.
Here at the $26,000, we'll need $5,000 more.
Yeah, maybe a little bit more if we have five server. But
okay, and the city, do you think the city will, if they're going to go on it too, do you think they'll?
This doesn't include the city's part.
Okay.
This the city's part is extra.
Okay.
So that's, and being that we are the dispatch center, it's up to us to have the burden of the dispatch part of the CAC, just like we do for the global. What they'll be able to do is link into it and link into the record management system part of it to make their interface to clear easier. I know I'm throwing out a bunch of stuff, but they don't have an electronic record keeping system right now. They want to get one. This is just an easy link. Instead of us having to take all their times and reports and print them off on a piece of paper, fax it over to them, they can go live into the CAD and just pull them off themselves.
So
they'll have an expense associated with it, but that's not included in this expense.
Okay.
And then I think there's going to be an interface for the EMS, but it's very, very minimal. I mean, $400 is a lot of money, but when you're talking $33,000, the additional for EMS is only $400, I think is about what it was. So.
10478094.
That's all really I had there. I'll make an announcement that Ann graduates Friday from the Kelly TC. I'm going down Thursday night so I can go to the graduation. So.
Did you need some executive session?
I need some executive session to talk about non-elected personnel.
Okay.
I'm going to go down to executive session.
Non-elected personnel. Okay, how long do you need?
15 minutes, tops.
Can we go five? Can we go, like, max 10?
We can go 10. Okay, we'll talk about
that. Okay.
Okay.
We're going to be going into executive session for non-elected personnel at 12 or 10, 9:56 and
10 minutes.